initially when the exhibition was only featured in Toronto, and now that it's traveling and it's at such a premier institution as the Monk School of Global Affairs, it warms my heart. So now that you've seen a little bit of the photographs and you've familiarized yourselves with the foundation, I wanted to tell you a little bit more about Turkmenistan. And it will give you a little bit of a context and background information as to what inspired the artist. I'll cover about our history, I'll talk about our holidays, and the reason why I'll talk about holidays is because they're very much intertwined with our culture. So, and I'll also cover an important topic, which is Turkmenistan's status of neutrality. There's not a lot of countries in the world that have that status, and we're very proud to be a neutral country. So I'll start from the basics, and before I go on, I wanted to ask you, how many of you have heard about Turkmenistan before? Raise your hand. That's great. We have a room full of people who are very familiar with Turkmenistan, which is quite rare. Whenever I travel to other places and I mention Turkmenistan, people look at me and say, can you say that again? Where is that? So Turkmenistan gained its independence on October 1991 as a result of the dissolution of the Soviet Union. Its territory is the second largest in Central Asia, and it borders Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Afghanistan, and Iran. I'll show you on the map right here. I'm from a Balkan region of Turkmenistan, which is on the Caspian Sea, but Kaya is from the Ahal region of Turkmenistan, which is where the artists live. It's closer to the Iranian side. Most of the territory of Turkmenistan is comprised of the 70% of it is comprised of the desert, the Karakum Desert. While many people will find the desert intimidating, Gurdubay Ramov was actually very much inspired with it, and he loved the desert. From my conversations with Kaya, he always found the desert very powerful and beautiful. So, on the next slide, I'll show you the flag of Turkmenistan and our national symbol. Here's the flag of Turkmenistan, and it was officially adopted on February 19, 1997. It features a white crescent, as you see, a symbol of Islam, and five stars. Those stars represent the five different regions of our country. Placed upon a green field is a symbolic representation of the country's famous carpet industry. As you see here, there's a whole bunch of display of different carpets. They're all handmade. So Turkmens are very proud of their carpet weaving industry, and so that went on our flag. Each one of the patterns that you see on the right side, on the left side, represents a different tribe of Turkmenistan. So there are five major tribes: Teke, Yomut, Chodur, Arsari, and Sarik, and they're in their chronological order, with Teke being the largest tribe in Turkmenistan. As a symbol of the country's status of neutrality in international relations, a golden olive wreath was added, similar to the one that you see on the flag of the United Nations. And similarly, the coat of arms that you see right next to the flag represents the tribes and stands for the traditional values of Turkmenistan. Green and red colors have always been praised in our culture. And the wheat that you see represents the salt and bread that the land provides. There is also cotton flowers that you see. Central Asia produces a lot of cotton, and Turkmenistan is actually the second largest cotton product exporter in the region. So in the middle of the coat of arms, you see a horse. And does anybody know which horse it is? And yes?
Akalteke.
It is an Ahalteke horse. This particular image is a lifelike image of our first president's horse that was named Yanardag. So now that we've sort of covered our symbol and our flag, I wanted to tell you a very quick rundown through our history so that you know where we are today and where we came from. This is just a very quick order of events, sort of say. While Turkmenistan is a very young nation, its history is rich and old. The territory of Turkmenistan has been populated since ancient times. Turkmen people, who were always horse breeders, and drifted into the territory possibly from the Altai Mountains. and grazed along the outskirts of the Karakum Desert into Persia, Syria, and Anatolia. Alexander the Great conquered the territory in the 4th century BC on his way to India. 150 years later, the Parthian kingdom took control of Turkmenistan, establishing a capital in Nisa, an area now located about 15 kilometers outside of Ashgabat. So, So this is the old Nisa, and it's now an area that you can go and explore and visit and take photos. Durdi Bayram was very much inspired by old Nisa, and he did one of my favorite abstract paintings, was this particular one, also by the artist. So, taking advantage of Turkmenistan's good position on the Great Silk Road, the Parthians had conducted an active economic and commercial life and established cities. It is worth noting that during this time, the biggest city in the world, as Kaya has mentioned, was located in Turkmenistan. It is called Mur, presently located nearby a city called Mari. Many of you probably have seen it and call it Mary, but we actually pronounce it as Mari. Mur is located about 10 kilometers away from where Durdi Bayram was born. This city was a stop on the Silk Road, where merchants traded for fresh horses and camels. It was around this time that the famous Silk Road was established as a major trading route between Asia and Europe. Today it is the oldest and best preserved oasis cities along the Silk Road. After Parthians, Arabs had conquered the region, bringing Islam to Turkmenistan and to the nearby countries. They sent thousands of troops into Merv and they established a base there. From Merv, they conquered most of Central Asia. Merv also functioned as one of the great cities for Muslim scholarship, science, and artists. I'll show you a picture of the, this is what was happening. This is the ruins that are outside of Mari, of the city of Merv, and it's UNESCO World Heritage Site. It's not ironic that actually Durdi Bayram himself was born in a village called Bayram Ali, which is very close to Merv. If you think of it today, a lot of Turkmenistan's prolific artists and people originate from, and also very entrepreneurial people originate from that area. It produced various scholars until it was later taken over by the Turkic leader, Alparslan, who Turkmen also admire, and subsequently, unfortunately, destroyed by Genghis Khan. Turkmens opened up the doors to Genghis Khan's son, and overnight they destroyed the city, killing over 1 million people. So after that, Turkmen history sort of went from one place to another. For the 7 centuries, Turkmens were under various empires and fought constant intertribal wars amongst themselves. However, by 1894, Imperial Russia had taken over Turkmenistan, and after 1917, the borders of Turkmenistan started emerging amongst other 15 republics. So ever since then, it was under the dominion of Russia until 1991. So I'll now mention a little bit about the status of neutrality. On a path as a young country, but we're a very old nation, which I've already mentioned before, one of the first decisions that Turkmenistan ever made was the Declaration of Neutrality of Turkmenistan that occurred during a special session of the United Nations on December 12, 1995. There are about 18 countries in the world that have the status of neutrality, and Turkmenistan is one of them, which means we don't take political sides, we sort of play the role of a mediator. It was for the first time in the practice of the United Nations that such a special status was given to a country via a special UN resolution. And that is why, as I mentioned earlier, the Turkmenistan flag, where you see the golden olive wreath, is symbolic of our neutrality status. So now I'd like to show you and talk a little bit about Turkmen holidays, the fun stuff. So Turkmen people have embraced all aspects of ancient Turkmen culture. At the root of Durdi Bayram's name, which we always talk about it amongst ourselves, is the word bayram, which means celebration or holiday. Turkmen people have always loved celebrating things, and they're very hospitable people, and they welcome different events. But Turkmen peoples have more holidays in the world than any other country. There are 12 official public holidays and two major Islamic holidays, one of which I'll talk about in a little bit. There are also 25 national and professional holidays, so combined Turkmen celebrate 39 official holidays every year. The holidays that we'll cover are the following. The Turkmen Carpet Day. Turkmen Carpet Day is celebrated on the last Sunday of May. This became a holiday in 1992 after the breakdown of the Soviet Union. The main purpose of this holiday is revival, preservation, and development of creative Turkmen traditions related to Turkmen carpet weaving. There are, usually that day, there are numerous concerts and events happening around Ashgabat. There are also lots of competitions where the government tries to find the best carpet makers who can carry out the tradition of carpet weaving. Every girl who is raised in Turkmenistan has somehow experienced seeing their grandmothers, and every child actually sees their grandmothers weaving a carpet growing up. And that's something that I had the pleasure of learning as a child. You, as a part of going to school, also had an opportunity to learn how to weave a rug. So now that I see it, there is some memories resurface of my grandmother showing me. And I'll tell you a little bit later, once the presentation is over, how to judge a good rug versus not the best rug. So we have a carpet museum in Turkmenistan, which has more than 2,000 Turkmen carpets on display, with some of them being very rare. There is also the world's largest Turkmen rug. It is 310 square meters, and it weighs 1,200 kilograms. Carpet weaving is an important part of Turkmenistan's economy. Durdi Bayramov often used carpets as a background in his paintings. And as you see here, I chose these specific photographs, which are a part of the exhibition. He took photos of carpet weavers, which he then later used as an inspiration for his paintings. This is one of my favorite paintings. It is currently housed at the Tretyakov State Gallery in Russia, and it is Durdi Bayramov's painting. It's actually quite large in size, but I don't remember the proportions off the top of my head. The burgundy or lush red is prominent in all of his paintings, as it is in all of Turkmen rugs. This is the largest rug in the world, the one that is housed at the museum in Turkmenistan. And so, as I said, Durdi Bayramov used our rugs as a background in all of his, in a lot of his art and portraits. These are just some of the basic examples. This one in particular has a traditional Turkmen rug behind it, and that one is called Keçe, also sort of felt, I don't know how you call it, how you name it in English, but it's also handmade, a different form of rug, I would say. There is not a Turkmen people living outside of Turkmenistan who does not have some sort of Turkmen carpet in their house. It's sort of, when you see a Turkmen rug, you instantly think, this is my home. On this note, I also wanted you to pay a special attention to traditional Turkmen dresses and costumes of Turkmenistan. It's wonderful that we're here in Toronto today, because when this exhibition travels, we can't necessarily take all of these things with us to show to people so they can touch and feel and get to experience the items in person. The clothes that you see are actually worn to this day in Turkmen culture. So Turkmenistan is one of the few countries in the world that where women and men on different celebratory occasions actually wear these costumes and outfits, and we're very proud of it. Everything is handmade, so it can take months to develop, but once it's put together, it's quite amazing. So I myself am wearing a Turkmen-made, handmade, we call it don, and this one is from Durdi Bayramov's collection, which is, I think, is quite beautiful. Thank you for letting me wear it today. as I said, you know, we wear it day to day and on different cultural occasions. Another thing I wanted to draw your special attention to is Turkmen jewelry. You'll see some displayed here on the table. In particular, I mean, pay attention to this. Not only women or men wore different pieces of jewelry, but it was also Turkmen horses. So this is a very heavy piece from the collection of Durdu Bayramov. So he used these as props for his paintings. And if you would like to take a peek later, please do so. Turkmen silver jewelry displays deep symbolic meaning and often mark the passage from one stage of life to another. From very early age, Turkmen women start wearing jewelry. The shapes and materials are believed to protect from and ensure the woman's ability to bear healthy children, to have a good life. The amount of jewelry a young woman wore increased over time as she approached the marriageable age. In addition to protective benefits, the silver medal is adorned with carnelians, the red stone that you see in a lot of Turkmen jewelry. Here you'll see on display. This would be a good piece to show right here. So these are the red carnelians, and this is made out of silver. Some jewelry pieces often have turquoise as a stone, but not as often as carnelians, and the turquoise stone serves as a symbol of purity and chastity. Even, you know, as I said, Turkmen horses were even adorned in jewelry. The nomadic culture of the people didn't allow for larger sort of investments and settling in one place or building a yurt or a house, so people put all of their valuables into designing the best jewelry they could, so they could easily, if they had to leave, could pack it up and go with them. On that note, I wanted to talk a little bit about celebration of a Turkmen horse day. Ahaltekin horses are considered to be one of the oldest horse breeds dating back 3,000 years. They're known for their ability to withstand severe weather conditions, and they're also known for their endurance, speed, and intelligence. Something that differentiates them is their distinctive metallic sheen. Ahaltekin horses are often referred to as the golden horses or horses from heaven, and it's hard to see why. They're considered to be one of the oldest modern domesticated equine breeds in existence. The breed as it is known today first appeared in Turkmenistan in the Karakum, a rocky flat desert surrounded by mountains, which played a significant role in preserving their purity. Tribesmen of Turkmenistan first used their horses for raiding, and they were selectively bred for speed and agility. I'll show you a photo. Next photo, it has circulated over the internet, but not a lot of people know that this is actually an Ahaltekin horse. Here's another photo up close. The Ahaltekin has a refined head with predominantly a straight or slightly convex profile and long ears. It can also have almond-shaped or hooded eyes. The mane and tail are usually sparse. The long back is lightly muscled, and it is coupled on a flat croup and long upright neck. The Ahaltekin possess sloping shoulders and thin skin. The breed is tough and resilient, having adapted to harshness of Turkmenistan lands where horses must live without much food or water. Durdu Bayramov was fascinated with these horses, and in 1986, after witnessing an entire race from the beginning to the end, which spanned a total distance of 1,300 kilometers and took 23 days to complete, he dedicated an entire series of drawings to this horse race titled Ashgabat Kunya Urgenç Ashgabat. So I'm going to show you some of his drawings. This is another example of the Ahaltekin horse. You see that they have a distinctly metallic sheen that shines when the sun hits it. So these are some of the quick sketches that he did just with a marker and any piece of paper that you could find while he was on the horse race, on the road with all of the cooks and support staff. I wanted to tell you a little fact about these So in 1935, a group of Turkmen riders rode 2,500 miles from Ashgabat to Moscow in 84 days, including 3-day across the 235 miles of desert without any water. The Ahaltekin, so that's something they're known for, that they are able to withstand a long distance without any water. And if these horses don't run, they essentially die. The Ahaltekin is also known for its form, grace, and is a very good show jumper. So these are some of the sketches by Durdu Bayram. We have so many more of them, but virtually I can't, for the limitation of time, I can't go through all of them. Next, I want to talk a little bit about Kurban Bayram, which is one of the Islamic holidays of Turkmenistan. Kurban Bayram is one of the most beloved folk festivals. It is celebrated nationwide in a special way. The first day begins with a solemn prayer service, which precedes the rite of sacrifice. While in most Muslim countries, this holiday is celebrated in special Islamic ways, Turkmens have developed their own ways of celebrating. Our background as pagans blended a lot of superstitions and symbolism into practice. As you see, you know, in this particular photo taken by Durdu Bayram when he traveled to different villages, the way people celebrate is by standing in line to get on the swing called Hinnilik. Whoever gets a chance to ride the swing, his sins get washed away. But it's I've been on one before, and it's a very scary experience. I believe it's a testament to survival. If you survive that, then you're good. Oftentimes the ride is so crowded and so many people are hanging on for their dear life. On these days, people wear fancy clothes, they visit their relatives and friends, and they entertain themselves with something called tzedakah, where they, you know, will give a sacrifice, a lamb, and make delicious pilaf, which you'll have a chance to experience today.
Excuse me?
And people meet each other with bushes.
That the Kurban Bayram, they find it a girlfriend, boyfriend, each other.
There you go.
It's an opportunity.
And Turkmen people are very hospitable. On this particular day, you don't need to be making appointments to come to other people's houses. You can just sort of walk in and they'll welcome you with open arms and feed you with as much as you can eat, and then sort of, and then some. So, and last but not least, I wanted to talk about a very special holiday, the Melon Day. Every second day of August, and it is celebrated around the time, at this particular time, because the melons and watermelons ripen, and they're harvested at this time. So it's a harvest holiday in a way. It's celebrated with so much music and dancing. On this day, the best melon growers and breeders of the country, winners of the traditional contest, Golden Melon Fields of the Golden Age, receive prizes and diplomas on behalf of the President of Turkmenistan. Melons in Turkmenistan are considered part of a great heritage. Whenever I remember as a child when we traveled to Moscow to visit our relatives, my mom put about 7 melons in our suitcase and wouldn't allow me to put anything else because she believed that that's the first thing they're going to ask if we brought Turkmen melons with us. So based on the research carried out by Turkmen scientists, there are now over 420 varieties of and biotypes of Turkmen melons that have existed over the last 14 centuries. Turkmenistan cultivates more than 200 locally selected varieties of melon. Most of them have been restored in the years of independence by the joint efforts of scientists and breeders. Durdu Bayramov truly loved all of the gifts of his motherland, and in that spirit he painted so many still lifes dedicated to melons, watermelons, fruits, and other delicious gifts from Turkmenistan. Here's an example of one of his paintings. The background is set on a Turkmen rug and sort of covered with different fruits and melons and apples, all of which are gifts from the motherland. And now, here's actually one more. This is from a harvest day when women are harvesting different fruits. I think it's a spectacular painting. It's currently hanging at the Fine Arts Museum in Ashgabat. Here Ashgabat today, a little more about, you know, modern day Turkmenistan. The country is developing, you know, at a rapid speed. The government has completely transformed Ashgabat in the past few years, in the past 10 years. Today it is in the Guinness Book of World Records for having the whitest marble city in the world. All of the buildings are made of Italian marble. It is all new. 2018 also marks a special year for Turkmenistan and was proclaimed to be the year of the heart of the Silk Road by the Turkmen president. You know, drawing from its experience and being located on the Silk Road, Turkmenistan's goal is to restore its trade routes, communication, logistical lines, economic partnerships. In that regard, the country is aiming to invest and partner with countries to strengthen regional, you know, Central Asian and international infrastructure projects. I know that one of them is building a railroad that would go through all of Central Asia, as well as physically restore the UNESCO heritage site of the old Merv that I showed earlier. In that spirit, the exhibition also plays an extremely important role, as Kaya mentioned, in opening up the discussion about the country's past and ways forward. We hope that the exhibition paves the road for more partnerships on behalf of, you know, and for more institutions to jump on board and to want to host this amazing exhibition. And especially partnerships that support and cultivate the arts. We think it's so important. Thank you so much for your attention. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me. I don't know if we have time, Kaya and Ed. How are we doing on time?
Well, we're getting very close to being ready, but maybe a few minutes.
Does anybody have any questions that I can answer while they're setting up the delicious food? I can tell you one thing, that if you come to a Turkmen house, you do not leave without having eaten an enormous amount of food. So, you know, in that spirit, we sort of decided to treat you all to Turkmen pilaf and samsa. And do not forget to take one, there's containers of apples. Please grab one on your way out. It's for all of our guests today. So, no questions.
No question about these apples.
Is there something special about apples? These apples.